Galatians chapter 4, starting in verse 8. The Apostle Paul writes, "Formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those by nature are not gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world, whose slaves you want to be once more? You observe days and months and seasons and years. I am afraid that I have labored over you in vain. Brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I also have become as you are. You did me no wrong. You know it was because of a bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. What then has become of your blessedness? For I testify to you that if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. Have I then now become your enemy by telling you the truth? They make much of you, but for no good purpose. They want to shut you out, that you may make much of them. It is always good to be made much of for a good purpose, and not for only when I am present with you. My little children, for whom I am again in anguish over childbirth, of childbirth until Christ be formed in you. I wish I could be present with you now and change my tone, for I am perplexed about you." We hear this overtone of Paul's emotion. Reading these words, you can tell that the Apostle Paul is a passionate person. What I want us to think about is, so often in the Christian life, we become Christians, or we're raised Christians. We're always talking about Jesus. And maybe at first in your walk, it was beautiful. It was like a honeymoon. Like, I don't know, for me, when I first became a Christian, I was 23 years old. I had no experience following Christ until that point. Wanted nothing to do with him. But he converted my soul. He regenerated my heart. And I wanted to spend as much time with him as possible. I carried my Bible around. I was one of those guys. I was one of those ones that, you know, you see and you're like, that's a Jesus freak. I mean, that's all he wants to talk about. That's all he wants to read about. There's like, he's infatuated with Jesus. I mean, come on, man. Get a grip, they used to tell me. You get in the real world. Talk about something other than Jesus. And at that time, I said, there ain't nothing more important to talk about than Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul said the same thing to the Corinthians. I knew nothing among you other than Jesus and him crucified. It's all he wanted to talk about. But then as time goes on, that honeymoon phase, that love that you once had, isn't as powerful. And sometimes you return to old ways of thinking and patterns that aren't becoming of the Lord. You're not walking, wasn't walking, and sometimes I don't walk according to the high calling of our purpose. What is your purpose? Why are you taking up space in this world? It's to glorify God, to love him with all of your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength, and love people. Love God and love people, your purpose. But so often, my purpose is to try to get out of bed on time, put on my shoes, you know, wrestle the kids in the morning to get them ready for school, get off to work, do my duties. And not so often am I thinking, how am I glorifying you today, God? And I go back to an old way of pattern of thinking. This is kind of what was going on with the Galatians, but they didn't see it. They didn't understand it. So Paul writes, and during these verses, he begins to explain some of the things that's going on. Let's look in verse 8. Formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those by nature are not gods. What is he saying? Oh, I love coffee. The Galatian people, these were pagan people. The ancient world was very religious, very religious. There wasn't atheists. But they were enslaved to the patterns and rituals of their pagan culture, which were many. They followed false gods such as Hermes and Zeus. But their culture was very religious, and they were enslaved to that religion. And Paul says, before you knew God, you were enslaved by nature to things that were not God. Verse 9, but now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God. Okay, that's important. A lot of us, even though you may not say you were religious before you followed Christ, you still were enslaved to the patterns of this world. You were still enslaved to things that were not God. Some would say it's food. Some could say it was some type of substance, whether it's alcohol or drugs. Some would say that it was lust. Some would say it's anger. Maybe you didn't struggle with alcohol, but you are the most rotten, hateful person that anybody knows. You're that one in the family that nobody wants to be around because you're a grouch all the time. You come to know Christ. Now you know God. And as Paul says, or rather, known by God. You see, even Paul is teaching these Galatian people about a relationship. A relationship to know God and to be known by God. You see, the Galatians couldn't know Zeus. They couldn't know Hermes. The Jews knew the law, but they didn't call God Father. No, it took a radical rabbi by the name of Yeshua from Nazareth, who said, when you pray, say Abba, which is an Aramaic word, a word of endearment, a word of personal intimacy with the Father. Jesus taught his people to pray this way, to be known by God and to know God. When we think about the patterns of our lives before Christ, and then sometimes even after Christ, are you concentrating on being known by God and knowing God? Because if you do, you have to spend time with God. A relationship takes time. Any husband and wife that have a good marriage would tell you that they have to have time together. Intimate time, conversating, hearing each other's aspirations and goals and struggles. You see, God desires that you would spend time with Him and wait on Him. He already knows what you're going through. He already knows your needs. But He says, you have not because you ask not. You see, God designed relationship that you would pursue Him. As it says in Hebrews, draw near to the Lord and He'll draw near to you. Paul's telling the Galatians here, you were at one time lost, not knowing God, enslaved to the rituals and culture, enslaved to false gods such as Zeus and Hermes, and now you have come to know the one true God and you are now known by God. How can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world? Don't you see that anything apart from Christ and your pursuit of Him is worthless and empty? These are cisterns that will never fill you up, whether it's your desire, is to be beautiful. Your desire is to be popular. Your desire is to gain knowledge. I mean, I could list it all out. If it's not first to seek Christ and His kingdom and His righteousness, those cisterns full of muddy water will always leave you empty. And that's what Paul is saying here. They were returning to the weak and elementary principles of the world, but they were not returning to pagan worship. What were they returning to then? Actually, they were turning to a new system, and that system was legalism. That system was following the ways of the Jews who said you have to be circumcised. You have to follow the Sabbath rituals. You have to follow all the Levitical laws. Now that's foreign to the Galatian people. They'd never done that before. So why is Paul saying they're returning to the elementary principles and worthless principles of the world? Because it's the same. It doesn't matter if you're following Zeus or Hermes and some ritualistic principle of culture, whether it's to gain knowledge, whether it's to gain fame, whether it's to gain whatever it is. Doesn't matter if it's 2,000 years old or today in 2017. You compare that with the same thing as trying to follow the Judaic law. It's the same. It's worthless. It's empty. It will never fill your heart. And it will leave you always in want. And that's the point that Paul is trying to tell them. You left this worthless pursuit of worthless gods. When I came to you and I preached the gospel and you received it, you received the grace of Jesus Christ, you have now been set free. And these Judaizers have come from Jerusalem lying to you, telling you that no, Paul had it wrong. He didn't tell you the whole story. You got to have Jesus plus your works. You got to work your way to God. The way to get God love you is that you're obedient. The way to have God pat you on the head and say, good job, little servant, is that you're perfect. Has any of you tried to be perfect? I mean, I last 30 seconds sometimes. I've never loved God the way He ought to be loved. And neither have you. I've never praised Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Word who became flesh, the way He ought to be praised. And I've never loved my neighbor the way I ought to love my neighbor. So earning your way to God is worthless. You can't do it. You can't. And you'll never have the motivation to do it. Coming to church, if you think it's because it's the right thing to do, rather than you get to come and be with the people of God, your mind is twisted. It's backwards. If you pursue the Bible as, well, I have to read it because I should. No, you've got it backwards. If you got a husband and wife, and they're new, okay, you got that new love, you know, and she writes a letter to him, if he picks up the letter and says, oh, I know I should read this letter, you know, I mean, it's the right thing to do, I don't do it enough, so I'll get my coffee, and I'll sit there, I'll flip Facebook a little bit, oh yeah, back to the letter. No. There's no love there. There's no motivation there. There's no genuine compassion there. There's no desire there. No. This is, I throw the phone across the room. I can't wait to open this letter and try to smell her. I try to read every word to figure out, oh, wow, she loves me. I love her. I can't wait to spend time with her. You see what I'm saying? Why did God give you the relationship, the picture of marriage? Why? He didn't have to. Why does He give us the picture of family, to have kids? Why? It's to show a picture of Him. This is an earthly picture. Why do we have dads? Listen, dads, we don't always do a great job. And your dad might not be a great dad. But you know what the Bible says? That you've been adopted into his family and you have full rights as sonship, as an heir, and you can call him Abba, Father. He is your Father. Jesus declared that to be true. They wanted to stone him. You realize that? We don't. When we pray and we say, Father, you know, we don't even realize how revolutionary that is. To call God your Father. No other religion would do this. Muslims don't call Allah Father. He's an impersonal God way out that you hope he has mercy upon you. You have no hope. You can't call him Father. Are you crazy? Same thing for Jews. They don't call Yahweh Father. They don't even write his name. We need a little more reverence, I think, in our culture. But at the same time, he tells us who we are. Now, returning. How is it that you can return to these elementary principles of the world whose slaves you want to become once more? He's like, you were slaves, and now you're going to be slaves again. And we do the same thing. We do the same thing when we try to pursue perfection for the motivation of earning God's love rather than pursuing perfection because God loves you already. There's a difference. Pursue loving my wife because I love her and she loves me, not that I'm going to try to earn her love. This is a big deal. You got to get a hold of this or your Christian life will be mundane and it will be like slavery and you will be like trudging through the grain rather than being taken from the mud and the mire and the muck and have your feet placed upon solid ground. All right. Now he goes on. You observe days and months and seasons and years. I'm afraid that I may have labored over you in vain. This is important. The Jewish law was important. And as I've already taught you, it had a purpose. It had a purpose to show you that you're sinful, to teach you that you need a Savior. Remember? The law was given that you would be under a guardian until Christ would come and you would be justified by faith. That mirror, you can't take down off the wall and wash your face with it. It's to show you you need a Savior. And you run to him. But they were being put under this yoke of slavery to observe certain days and years, certain seasons, certain months. You got to observe the Jubilee year. Okay, every 50 years there was a Jubilee year. You got to observe the Sabbath year, every seventh year. You got to observe all of the feasts. You can't work on Sunday. I'm sorry, we can't go to the grocery store to buy chips for my 7-layer dip because it would be sinful. Now that's ridiculous. 7-layer dip is in heaven, you guys know that. Now, it's important because you know why? You're going to run into people. You're going to run into Christians who are going to say, you guys, you don't have it, see? No. You don't keep the Sabbath. The Sabbath is on Saturday, not Sunday. And they're going to try to push this upon you, to come under this yoke of slavery. And you're going to say, oh no, I'm sorry. You see, Jesus Christ has come to fulfill the law. Jesus Christ has come to set me free. That through him I'm adopted as a son into the family of God with the full benefits of being a son. I'm an heir to the throne with Christ, in Christ, the offspring. I am in that offspring. That's what the Word of God teaches us. Now, verse 12, brothers, I entreat you to become as I am, for I also have become as you are. Now, what is he saying there? What he's saying is I am pleading with you to be as I am, and that is free. I am free from the law of Moses. I am free. As he says in another place, he says, everything is law for me, but not everything is beneficial. He is free from the law. He says, guys, become as I am, for I have become as you are. What does he mean by that? Well, these were Gentile people. These were Gentile people. Now, who was Paul? A Pharisee who held himself to the highest, strictest level of Judaism. To the letter, he followed the law, and now he's saying, I have become as you are. I have, like, become a Gentile. I don't think that way anymore. He's saying, become as I am, which is free, because I have become as you are. Meaning, Jew and Greek, Gentile, all the same, one under Christ. There is no male nor female, nor slave nor free, Jew or Greek, one under Christ. That's what he's saying. And we need to hear that today. Be free in Christ. A lot of times when we hear messages on grace, I'll hear the comeback of, well, you got to be careful, because when you preach like that, what it's telling people is they have a license to sin. We can't have a license to sin, you know. You don't want a bunch of sin in the church. I don't know what church you're going to, dude. There's sin in the church. And there's ways to deal with that sin. Matthew 18, Galatians 6, 1. It's not a license to sin. That is ridiculous. You know what that's saying? You got a husband and wife. I love to use this picture because God uses it to explain the relationship of Christ and the church. So, you got a husband and wife. Husband says, man, I love my wife. I love her. She loves me. She gives me grace. She gives me mercy. I don't have to, like, follow this ritual where I have to buy her flowers every other Saturday, and I have to buy her chocolates on the third of every month by this rule. No, no, no. We get to love each other freely, and I love her so much. She loves me so much that I can just go run around with other women. That's the reaction, right? I mean, it's like, that's stupid. That's crazy. That's the same argument. Preaching a message of grace through Jesus Christ, that you're justified by faith, is a license to sin? No, no, I'm sorry. You see, you're not understanding this at all. You're like, whoop! Bam! I mean, this is the word of God's being preached, and the devil comes and gets it before it's even sowed in your heart. A license to sin? Let it never be. This is why Paul says over and over again, he says, banish the thought. Banish the thought. Because when you realize the love that you are given in Christ Jesus, when you realize that the Father has put his hand upon you and called you his child, when you realize that your sins have been forgiven, guess what? As it says in Titus, the grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodly things. You see that husband and wife that are in that loving relationship? And they're just so focused and infatuated with each other. Read some Song of Psalms, man. They are like so in love. And some other woman or some other man comes by and whistles their direction. They don't even hear it. They don't even pay attention. They have no eyes for no one else. Because they're so in love. The relationship with God. When you're following God and you are in relationship with Him and you're pursuing Him for the right reason, not under slavery, but under grace, under His love, and you realize that He first loved you before the foundation of the world, that you were predestined to be blameless and washed clean in His sight. When you take these truths, guess what? The things of the world aren't as attractive. You don't want them. You know they taste bad. It's like you look at the apple. I'm not going to say you're not going to be tempted. We're all tempted. But you know there's a razor blade in that apple when you eat it. Going on. Brothers, I entreat you to become as I am, for I also have become as you are. You know there was a body because of a body ailment that I preached to you the gospel at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. Okay, what's he talking about? There's many speculations that's going on around in the Christendom for years, and they kind of speculate. What is he talking about? Well, he gives us a little bit more information where he says, for I testify, if possible, this is verse 15, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. So we know that there was a body ailment. When Paul went to Galatia and preached the gospel, he had to stay there a little bit longer. He had a trial. It says it was a physical trial, okay? And then he says, you received me in as if I was a messenger of God, as if I was Christ Jesus. And if possible, you would have given me your eyes. What happened? I don't know. Maybe he had a really bad case of conjunctivitis. Maybe, I mean, obviously it was a body ailment. It was some type of sickness. And given the information that he's saying, if possible, you would have given me your eyes, I think that he had some kind of disease in his eyes. And what does it say? You didn't despise me, but you received me. And it caused him to stay longer to preach the gospel. So what does that tell us? Number one, it tells us Christians have compassion for each other. And you know what else it tells us? Sometimes God may cause a body ailment to come upon you for his purposes. I know there's preachers out there that will tell you, nope, if you name it and claim it and you just believe it, by his stripes we are healed, and you just banish the thought and you banish this and bind that and all this business. Listen, Paul prayed 3 times to God, and God said, no, my grace is sufficient for you. This shows us that because of this problem with Paul's eyes, he had to stay longer with the Galatians. And God caused that to happen. Now, sometimes Satan is involved in this too. But you know what's amazing? Whenever we read an account of something like this happening, and Satan may try to do this or that, it says, what he meant for evil, God turned around for good. And he works all things together, whether it's cancer, whether it's a tragedy and someone really close to you passes away, or whether it's you lose your job. He works all things together for the good according to his purpose. Keep reading. It says his purpose is that you would be conformed to the image of Christ, who has, Corey said, suffered and was humiliated. Philippians tells us it's granted to you not only to believe on Christ, but to suffer for his name's sake. We live in such a culture, and I'm stuck here too. I don't like to be uncomfortable. I don't like to suffer. I complain. Boy, I'm a complainer. And I need to confess it as sin. I complain to God all the time. Well, another Sunday, I got to get up there and say something? I can't do this. Somebody else. But God be glorified. His purpose, not mine. So, what he's saying here is he's establishing this relationship, this love between him and the Galatian people. He's saying, you received me as if I was Christ Jesus himself. And if possible, you loved me so much, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. Do you love your Christian neighbor, brother, or sister that much? You'd be willing to gouge out your eyes and give it to them? Here's another question. Do you know people well enough? Now listen, Paul and Galatians just met. They just started hanging out. But it was that instant connection. Do you know someone well enough? Or do you love them enough that you'd be willing to gouge out your eyes and give them to them? See, this is why Jesus said, my disciples, the world will know that you are my disciples. Because of your love for one another. Yes, God is glorified when you go down to the homeless shelter and feed a sandwich or some soup. That's good, and we should do that. But do you love your neighbor? Do you love the people in your church, and do you even know them? This is why it's important that we are in life group. Life group. We meet in each other's homes. We pray together. We're transparent. You know what we talk about sometimes? You know what? Some of us in this church have some problems. We're not all perfect. Imagine that. Yeah, for real. Some of us actually have some little friction in our marriage. I know. Woo, shocker. Some of us have a hard time raising kids. But you know what? We do it together. We pray together. We text and say, how are you doing? How can I pray for you today? How can I encourage you today? If you come here and you want to be part of this church and just sit here, sorry, this is too small of a church for that. There's lots of them around you can go to. Got really nice, comfortable chairs, better coffee. Even our coffee's really good, I think. We got some styrofoam cups. This will be a church in which we will love each other. Now, I know we got to close. Have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? That's a big one. Verse 16. Not only do you love each other where you can give your eyes, but you got to love each other enough to tell each other the truth. You got to love each other enough to say, you know, that's not God's best for you. And here's what the Word has to say about it. Let's read it together. Let's pray together. I know it's hard. I know it's a struggle. I know you're struggling. I've struggled too. But I got to tell you the truth. I got to tell you the truth. What you're doing is not bringing God glory, and it's not good for you. Sin will never be good. It may taste good for a little while. It may feel good for a little while. But in the end, let me tell you, those tears that are cried, whether they're godly sorrow or they're worldly sorrow, they're still tears, and sin hurts. It takes you longer and further than you ever want to go, and makes you stay longer than you ever want to stay. And you know what? You may have avoided it if someone loved you enough to grab your hand before you walked across that door pane and said, stop, don't go that way. No, there's a better way. Come here with me. I know you're struggling, but I'm going to bear with you. I'm not going to let you go. Somebody got to tell you the truth. And don't be one of those that, oh, they're judging me. Stop judging me. You know what it says? When you do judge, make sure you've taken the log out of your own eye. Jesus said, do not judge. But then he went on. That wasn't the only thing he said. He said, when you do, make sure that you're not caught up in the same stuff. Don't be a hypocrite, man. Okay, remove your log. Then you can see clearly to help your friend, your brother, remove the speck in his eye, because we all got specks. But you got to be man or woman enough to admit it and say, I need help. Don't be out there in the ocean trying to survive with a life vest that's old and mildewed, and you're going down. Don't do that. Say, I need help. That's what the church is for. Now, have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? Sometimes you got to speak the truth in love, even if people don't like it. They make much of you, but it's for no good. See, the Judaizers were lying to them, trying to put them back under this yoke of slavery. They want to shut you out. Shut you out of what? The grace of God, the truth of the gospel, that you would make much of them. Oh, those Judaizers, boy, from Jerusalem, they had better teaching than Paul. They taught us how to be circumcised, and they taught us how to follow all the rituals, and now we're religious people, and we know we're doing doing everything right. Forget the grace of God through the cross of Jesus Christ. That's just a little sprinkle, see? The rest we got to do on our own. Sounds a lot like Mormonism. It's really in the Book of Mormon. It says, we are saved by grace and everything you can do. That you would make much of them. It's always good to be made much for the good purpose. Not only when I am present with you, my little children. Verse 19 and 20, we'll close. Paul calls them children. And then he uses the imagery and anguish of childbirth. Now us men, we don't have a clue what that's like. Paul didn't either. But he observed it enough to know it was anguish. And you know, a woman who gives birth to a child is one of the most amazing things I've ever witnessed. And to see my wife go through anguish, but she had the goal in mind. She knew it wouldn't last forever, and the goal was to give birth to my child. That kind of love, willing to do that, willing to go through the anguish, that the baby would be born, and here the metaphor is that Christ would be formed in them. I anguish that Christ would be formed in you. I anguish that Christ would be formed in me. I got a rotten heart sometimes. I got to wrestle with it. I ask God, beat it up, grind it to powder. Do whatever you got to do to make me submitted to you, that Christ be formed in me. And this love, this picture of childbirth, he's willing and he's going through. I am again in anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. You see, childbirth, labor is intense. It's no joke. It's an intense thing. When my wife was giving birth to my sons, you know, the last one, my daughter there at the house, oh boy, I was scared, even though, you know, hey, I'm a medical professional. I was scared. But to see the determination in her eyes, to see the goal, what she was doing, and willing to do it, they ain't no joke. The Christian life ain't no joke. Pursue God with the fervency of a woman giving birth to a child, and you'll see your entire life change. You'll see things revolutionize in your life. You'll see things like anxiety and depression, things that we deal with sometimes. I know I deal with. Be replaced with joy. Even though it might be a fight. Labor is called labor for a reason. It's not called fun. The Christian life can be laborsome. But are you willing to do it? Are you willing to pursue God? Are you willing to get up in the morning and wait on the Lord? Wait on Him. Don't leave until you have communed with God. And don't go back to the yoke of slavery of the elementary principles of the world. It's as if you're swimming upstream the Christian life. Everything else is going downstream. The easy way. The road that is broad and leads to destruction. Don't give up and allow the current to take you down. No, keep swimming. Keep swimming with the fervency of labor. Pursue God. Draw near to Him. He'll draw near to you. Let's pray.